We will be looking at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. We are looking at fighting the good fight of faith from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. May I read verse 12 of chapter 6? Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you are called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Now, as we look at this passage, there is one thing that comes to our mind regarding the journey of faith on which all of us are walking. And one of the things that will obviously come to our mind is how fighting could in any way be associated with the Christianity. Now, when we look at this passage, we realize that Paul is writing to Timothy after outlining many other aspects of the Christian life from the first verse to the 11th verse, which are issues to do with doctrine, issues to do with contentment, issues to do with money, which are issues that beset the Christian life. And in verse 12, he commands him to fight as a soldier of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it may be our experience that as we've lived in this life, particularly for those of us who are believers, that we have found our flesh lusting against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. So that on many occasions, as Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, we are not able to do what we would like to do. Now, while we look at this, we feel that there is a war within ourselves, and there is a war between ourselves and the people around us, particularly those not of the faith. And as we try to understand why and how this happens, we should realize that this is one of the evidences that we are Christians. Because the flesh, or the devil in this case, will not fight those who are on his side. The fact that we are being fought by those who are not of Christ, the fact that we are at conflict with the devil, is a clear indication that we are on the right path. For that means that then those things that we are fighting against are not on the same side with us, and therefore they are against Christ. And it is a mark of a Christian that there is an inward warfare, a warfare that is irreconcilable in this life, a warfare where there is no peace, there is no ceasefire, there is no agreement at any point in this war. It is a war that begins the moment one becomes a believer until the person dies or until the Lord returns. And it is a war that is inevitable. So this evening, we are looking at this war that the Christian fights in his entire life. And as we look at this, I would like us to shed some light on this from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 to 6. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 to 6. It says, share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is the hard-working farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Now, as we look at this passage in 2 Timothy, we find it begins with a command that share in suffering. And this is even more clearer in the King James Version, where it says, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Now, there are three professions that are mentioned in this passage. One is a soldier, the other one is an athlete, and the third one is a farmer. If there is anything we can associate with these three professions, is that they are all marked by hardness and endurance. And you will realize that in the passage we've just read, the soldier is not just described as a soldier. So you are not just urged to be a soldier. The passage clearly says, qualifies it, and said, you endure suffering or you endure hardness as a good soldier. When it talks about an athlete, it doesn't just tell you to endure hardness as an athlete. It says, an athlete who competes according to the rules. When it talks about a farmer, it doesn't just tell you to endure hardness as a farmer. It tells you to endure hardness as a hard-working farmer. Now, when we look at a good soldier, an athlete that competes according to the rules, and a hard-working farmer, one thing that comes out clearly is that these are people who have endured a lot of difficulties for them to be where they are. If you are familiar with any soldier or even policeman, or if you have come in contact with them, I'm sure you are aware of quite a number of them drop out from the training because of the kind of training they go through. And even for those who manage to go through the training, you are aware of those who run away from the battlefield because of the kind of work they are supposed to do. All of us, maybe in school or in colleges or even in the national championships, we are aware of athletes. When they begin a 5,000-kilometer race, if there are 100, probably only 20 or 15 will finish. Those of us who have lived close to farmers, especially in the villages, you know that not all farmers continue with the same practice year in, year out. Most of the time, they give up on the way. These are the three professions which are compared to a Christian. This typically tells us that we are engaged in a race that is marked by difficulty. And that's why Paul tells Timothy that endure hardness, not just as a soldier, but as a good soldier. The one who will finish the training and the one who will go to the battle until he attains victory. Endure hardness as an athlete, not just the one who goes to the field to run for 2 laps and give up, but one who competes according to the rules and wins the crown. He also says, endure hardness as a hard-working farmer, not just a farmer who goes to the fields and does a little work. When he sees there are no clouds, he gives up. But one who will have the first share of the crops is the hard-working farmer. Now, when we look at this passage and many other passages we will come across, we see the phrases used like, fight the good fight, endure hardness, put on the whole armor of God. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Strive to enter by the straight gate. Labor for the meat that endureth unto eternal life. Christ himself says, think not that I come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. Watch ye and fast. War a good warfare. This is the language that is used throughout the New Testament to describe the life of a Christian. And as we look at the passage in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12, it is incumbent upon us to understand that what is presented in this passage is the whole tone of the New Testament. That Christianity is not a race in which someone would sleep and doze his way to heaven. It is not a life of religious ease. It is a life of endurance. It's a life of suffering. It's a life of commitment. It's a life of total dedication. Those who do not count the cost, as we've seen the example of the soldier, the athlete, and the farmer, will definitely give up on the way. Now, as we look at this passage, it tells us that this is a good fight. So we ask ourselves, why is the fight good? Because that's the question that will come to our mind when we come across such a passage. The Bible is describing this fight as a good fight. Why is it good? Let's look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Now, when we look at this, the first thing that comes out from this passage in Hebrews, that this fight is good because it is fought under the command of the Master General, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, we know that we are not told just that the fight is good, but it is a good fight of faith. It would have meant a totally different thing if we were just commanded, fight the good fight. But because we are told, fight the good fight of faith, then the question is, faith in what? In the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, all of a sudden, the Lord Jesus Christ comes on the stage and takes charge of the fight. For it is a fight of faith. It's not any other fight. Now, it is therefore a good fight Because the commander of all believers is the Lord Jesus Christ, and is the one who leads this fight. As we know who the gracious Savior is, he has perfect wisdom and infinite knowledge. He cannot make errors in his judgment while on the battlefield. He never commits mistakes as he's leading his soldiers. He never makes useless movements. He takes care of all the soldiers in his army. The humblest servant in Christ's army is not forgotten. The weakest and even most sickly is graciously taken care of. And the Lord Jesus himself, through his blood, he has not wasted any opportunity, but has purchased and redeemed all. And he has promised to bring all safely at home. Therefore, this fight is good because it is a fight that is commanded by none other than the Lord Jesus Christ himself. We know that apart from Christ, there is no salvation. It is through him and his death on the cross that those who become believers are actually able to claim to be believers, because we don't believe in anything else except Jesus Christ himself as our Lord and Savior. And therefore, those who come to him and those who believe in his death and his resurrection are those who are enlisted in his army as his soldiers. And therefore, when we are commanded by Paul to fight the good fight of faith, it is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, we are assured that this is a good fight because the Lord himself is in control. The second thing we will look at is, why is this fight good? The fight is good because it is waged with excellent training from the Holy Spirit. We could read this from John chapter 16, verse 13. It is very clear from the Gospels, not just the Gospel of John, but throughout the Gospels, it's very clear that the Holy Spirit indwells believers. When Christ was living, he promised that the Holy Spirit will come. And one of the things that the Holy Spirit will do is that he will teach, he will lead, he will guide, he will comfort, and he will direct all those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, when someone believes in Christ, the Holy Spirit indwells the person. And therefore, the person is not left on his own. The warfare no longer is the person's warfare. All the charges he makes are charges directed by the Holy Spirit. His movements are not defective, for the Holy Spirit ensures that he makes the right movements. When he's supposed to escape from any danger, he does not do it out of his own wisdom. The Holy Spirit provides the wisdom to escape from the danger. When he's supposed to aim at his target in this war, the Holy Spirit guides the believer to aim at the target. When the Bible commands the Christian to flee from sin, to flee from evil, the Christian is not able to flee by himself. The Holy Spirit enables the Christian to flee. So it is a war that is entirely controlled by the Holy Spirit for the excellent training that he gives through sanctification. He is the ever-present friend to the person who has committed his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, on this basis, this fight is a good fight, because it's as a fight of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ with the assistance of the Holy Spirit. The third thing we see from this passage, it is that this fight is good because it yields tremendous results. We know that those who have committed their lives to Christ, it was not a personal choice that they made. It is not a personal decision. Left on our own, none of us could choose to be here professing Christ. These are people who have been foreknown by God Himself, and He has called them. So we are here because we have responded to the call that God the Father Himself has given us. And that call, we are told in the scriptures that all those who have been called will be justified. We are also promised that all those who are justified will be sanctified. And we are also promised, we are also told that those who are sanctified will be glorified. Now this means that we are more than conquerors. We are not just conquerors, but we are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. Despite the struggles, the agonizing conflicts, the wounds, the bruises, the watchings, the fastings, the fatigue that every believer goes through, we are assured that no soldier of Christ will ever be lost. That is a tremendous result that we all expect. We are sure that in this fight, there will be no soldier that will be missing in the battlefield. There will be no soldier that will be found dead on the battlefield. There will be no mourning to be put on or tears to be shed for a believer because he has been lost or because he has died in his fight of faith. For Christ Himself and the Holy Spirit are in charge. When the master roll is called at the end of the day, when the last evening comes, the list will be found exactly the same as it was in the morning. That is a tremendous result that we expect for those who enter this battlefield. For we know that Jesus Himself has said, "Those whom you have given me," in John chapter 18, verse 9, "I will lose none." And that, to us, is a tremendous result. And that makes this fight of faith a good fight. The fourth thing we look at is that this fight is fought on the basis of exceedingly great and precious promises. We are promised in God's word that sin shall not have dominion over you. And this is a promise the Lord Himself has made. This is a promise that the Holy Spirit is committed to keep. That at no time will sin be the master of our lives. We are promised that the God who has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is a promise we have been given. And it's a promise that has been given by God Himself and which He has to keep. And therefore, that is a precious promise from the Lord Himself. We are promised that my sheep shall never perish, neither shall any man be able to pluck them out of my hands. So that those whom Christ has held, they are held eternally. No one will be able to pluck them from the hands of Christ. Paul says that I'm persuaded that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. These promises are given as an assurance to us that the fight we are being called upon to fight is not our own fight. We have been given precious and great promises on which we can rely as an assurance that we will be able to reach home safely, because the Lord Himself has promised that this fight you are fighting is not your own fight. I am with you, and I'll not depart from you. Sin will not have dominion over you, and I'll not forsake you. So those are the four things we find in this passage that tells us that this fight must be a good fight. The next thing we will look at is who is the adversary? We've been called to fight. Then the question is, whom are we fighting? You've been given all the promises. We have the assurance that all will go well. But then, whom are we fighting? Let's read this from Romans chapter 7, verse 21. We will find that the first thing we are fighting is the flesh. Romans chapter 7, verse 21. I read, "So I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being. But I see in my members another law, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh, I serve the law of sin." Paul is giving his personal experience with the fight that he has with the flesh. And we acknowledge that it is a personal experience to all of us who are believers, that we have a fight that is within us. There is a principle within us which wants us to do right, and there is another principle which wants us to do wrong. Now, because Christ dominates our lives as believers, it is expected that most of the time we will do what the principle of doing right commands. But then this does not come to an end. It's an endless war that keeps on piercing us again and again, that there is a struggle within us. And as we said at the beginning, that is a clear evidence of a believer, that there is no peace between you and the sin that still dwells within you. And this is what Paul is describing in this passage. And therefore, we are urged to mortify the works of the flesh. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, we are urged to mortify, to kill, to bring under control, to bring under subjection the works of flesh in us, so that we may be able to do the will of God. So one of the things that we need to fight is the flesh. And the ways through which to fight the flesh is by using the means of grace that the Lord has provided. And that begins with prayer. For us to fight the flesh, we must be a prayerful people. We should not just be contented with the prayers that are offered in the church or in the congregation of believers in our midst. Personally, we have a war at our hands, and that war cannot be fought unless we pray. So we need to have a dedicated heart of prayerfulness, specifically to deal with sin in our lives, the sin that indwells all believers. So that is the first adversary that we are fighting. The second adversary that we are fighting is the world. Now, this is all around us. In a way, all of us have a certain amount of love for the good things of this world. It is difficult for us to be able to control ourselves and know how far can we go in our love for money, in our love for education, in our love for jobs, in our love for houses, in our love for cars. It is through the scriptures and through the help of the Holy Spirit that we can be able to moderate our appetites to these things. Sometimes we fear the world's laughter or ridicule or blame on ourselves, particularly when we are doing the things of God, and that is sinful. Sometimes we harbor secret desires to keep in tune with the world. There's something that everyone around us is doing, and we don't want to be the odd one out. We want to be fashionable. We want to appear to be modern. We want to appear to be moving along so that we are not left behind. These things drive us into sin. And as we are urged to fight a good fight, one of the adversaries is the world. We are told in the scriptures that the friendship with the world is enmity with God. And it is declared very clearly in 1 John that whoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. So we need to ensure that we are not conformed to this world. For as long as the standards of the world are not in tune with the things of God, we have to resist the standards of the world. The world is our enemy. The world is not our friend. The things that the world offers are not geared towards promoting the kingdom of Christ. We cannot promote the cause of this fight if we are in comradeship with the world around us. So we should not fear to be seen to be extremists. It is very common, especially those who are in colleges. If you spend so much time going to pray, you're given a tag. You're called a fanatic. We should not fear to be called these names if we endeavor to please our God. We will be called all these names But we cannot change our standard to conform to the standard of the world. For the world is not our friend. The third adversary that we are fighting in this war is the devil himself. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 to 10, we are presented with the devil as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He's presented as one who does not sleep, who does not rest, but a lion represents a strong person who is armed and who is ready to destroy. He's described in the scriptures as a murderer and a liar from the beginning, who labors day and night to drag us into hell. Sometimes he leads us into superstition. Sometimes he brings fears and doubts about our faith. Sometimes he suggests infidelity. He uses all tactics to campaign against the state of our souls. And therefore, in this battle, that is one of our targets. He is our enemy, and we have to overcome him. We have to use the whole armor of God to ensure that we overcome the devil and his pursuits against us. So we need to be on guard at all times. When we want to do the right thing, when you want to go to church in the morning, and there is a neighbor who is calling you for something else, or a relative who wants your attention for something else that is not an emergency, the devil may be using the people around us to derail us from the path on which Christ has set us. And therefore, we need to be on guard and fight the good fight of faith. The third and last thing that we are looking at is, what is the end result? As we look at this passage again, 1 Timothy, chapter 6, verse 12, we are told, fight the good fight of faith, take hold of the eternal life. Now, the idea of taking hold of eternal life implies that eternal life will not just come while we are sitting down. The necessity of fighting that fight is so that we may take hold of eternal life. We will not inherit the kingdom of God by just sitting down and waiting. The scriptures command us to fight. And when we fight the good fight, the end result is we will get hold of eternal life. Eternal life is a reward for those who have overcome. And those who have overcome are those who have endured the hardness of the journey. There is no shortcut of inheriting the kingdom of God. If we recall what we said at the beginning, the phrases used in the scriptures, fight, strive, labor, enter by the narrow gate. These are not things that can be done by someone who is relaxed and waiting to be rewarded at the end. We will be struggling with the sin within us, fighting not to be in tune with the world, but to influence the world, and resisting the devil at all costs, so that in the end, we may be able to attain eternal life. Another thing that we will gain from this fight is that there is a crown of glory awaiting us. We read this in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. It says, "And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory." Now this, it is a common thing even in our secular lives, that when soldiers go to fight, when they come back, they are given medals, they are given honors, they are given titles. But for us who are believers, we are promised an unfading crown of glory by the chief shepherd himself, who is the commander of this army, the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are not fighting in vain. It is not a question of saying, "Well, you have told me that the fight is good, and you have told me I'm fighting the flesh, the world, and the devil. But what do I gain out of all this?" At least the scriptures are not silent about why we are fighting, that there is a crown of glory and there is eternal life for those who overcome. Perhaps you may be struggling very hard for the rewards of this world. Perhaps you are straining every nerve of your body to obtain money or position or power or pleasure. If that be the case, please consider that there is a more worthy battle for you to spend your energy, your time, and your resources. Because these things on which we spend our time striving, struggling, and fighting for, they are things that will fade away. When the time comes of your departure from this world, or when Christ returns, those things you have been striving for will become a bitter disappointment. Unless you mind what you are about, your latter end will lie down in ruins. Because thousands have trodden that path and have pursued that way, but they have ended up in misery. They have fought hard for wealth and honor and promotion and office, and turned their backs on Christ. But at their latter end, as we see in the story of Lazarus and the rich man, it has been a bitter disappointment of how they spent their lives. So as I conclude, I would urge you to shake off your past carelessness and unbelief while on this journey. Come out from the world and live as a soldier of the Lord Jesus Christ. Take up the cross and prove yourself as a good soldier. Fight the good fight of faith so that you may take hold of eternal life. If you see what the kingdoms of this world do, when we look at Israel at the moment, or Palestine, when we see all the things they are doing, which results even in the loss of life, loss of some of the things that are so precious to them, for the mere reason that they don't want to be under a foreign neck. They want to have freedom. This kind of example of the world and how they struggle to protect their kingdom should be a matter of envy to us who are in the kingdom of Christ. How much are we willing to give up for the sake of this kingdom? If men can do so much for a corruptible crown, how much should we do for a crown that is incorruptible? For those who have not begun this journey, fear not to begin and enlist under Christ's banner. The great captain of your salvations rejects none that comes to him. He is ready to receive all who come to him, however unworthy they may be. If you repent your sins and believe, however rotten your lifestyle has been, the Lord Jesus Christ will enroll you in the ranks of his army. All who come to him by faith are admitted, clothed, cleansed, armed, trained, and led to complete victory. Fear not to begin this day. There is yet room for everyone who comes to him in faith. Those of you who are already in this fight, fear not to continue fighting. The more thorough and wholehearted you are as a soldier, the more comfortable you'll be on this journey. There is no doubt that you'll often meet trouble, fatigue, and hard fighting before the warfare is accomplished. But let none of these things discourage you. Greater is he that is for you than all they that are against you. There are two choices that we all need to make. It's a choice of everlasting freedom and everlasting captivity. So as you fight, as we've already said, we are fighting for the cause of our kingdom. We are fighting against sin. We are fighting and resisting the devil. We are fighting the world and its standards in order for us to attain eternal liberty. The other choice is eternal damnation. And as wise people, those who have not made this choice, it's a choice worth making. For as we've said, it is not a battle of your own. The Lord Jesus Christ is the commander, and the training is from the Holy Spirit, and it is a war you cannot lose. The results are already guaranteed. The promises are there. The Lord will surely bring us home safely. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that it pleased you to send him into the world to die for sinners, a people who had profaned your name, a people who are groping in darkness, a people who had rebelled against you. These are the people for whom you send your precious Son, Jesus Christ, to die. And Lord, we are pleased this evening that we are among those for whom he died and for whom he suffered. And we are proud, Lord, to belong to the army of Christ, that we are his soldiers, that he has promised to be our chief shepherd and to command our battalion and lead us to victory. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit may continue to train us on this journey and equip us for your service, that we may not derail from the path that you've set before us. May you humble us before your throne of mercy and enable us to seek your presence all the time, that we may put all our confidence in you. For, Lord, apart from you, we can do nothing. Be pleased, Lord, to sanctify us and equip us and train us and direct us and teach us and enable us, Lord, to walk with you, to follow you, to walk with you and obey you, and to listen to you and to follow your word, that your will may be done in our lives as it is in heaven. For it is in the wonderful name of Christ we believe and pray. Amen.